Sup, my name is Bernard, and welcome to Weekends with Dr. Bernie. Should gay people be allowed to donate blood? We'll answer that question today. In June 2016 in Orlando, Florida, one of the biggest mass shootings occurred here in the United States. 49 people at a gay nightclub were killed, and more than 50 people were injured. This prompted a huge, huge influx of people wanting to donate blood, because in a mass shooting, you lose blood if you've been shot. If you don't have enough blood, your organs in your body won't be able to get enough oxygen. Most importantly, the brain. And if it doesn't get enough oxygen, then you die. There's also a multitude of other problems that happen when it comes to massive blood loss. So this prompted a lot of people to want to give blood. However, the United States Food and Drug Administration has banned gay people, gay men who have had sex with men, from donating blood. Now, I should say this guidance has been revised. If you are a gay man and you haven't had sex in the last year and you test HIV negative, you are able to donate blood. But if you don't fit any one of those two criteria, you are not able to donate. Now, let's go into why you're not able to donate. HIV is the biggest infectious disease epidemic that's occurred since 1950. It stands for human immunodeficiency virus and inevitably leads to something called AIDS, which is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. It's not the HIV or the AIDS that kills you. It's the result that comes from those that do. What AIDS does is that it eventually weakens your immune system to the point where your body's not able to fight off things that normally occur and that people with healthy, functioning immune systems are able to fight off. Meaning that you can get extremely strange and rare fungal pneumonias, you get fevers all the time, and pretty much your body becomes infected repeatedly until you die. The first cases of these infections were found in 1981. Five men in Los Angeles had a very rare fungal pneumonia and they all died from it. And throughout the early 80s, AIDS was known as the gay man's cancer because it seemed to only affect gay men and nobody knew exactly how it was transmitted. Until the mid-80s in the US, there was a kid named Ryan White who was a hemophiliac, meaning that he had blood issues and needed new blood transfused into him very often. Now, after a bad transfusion occurred in December 1984, he then got infected with HIV, which ultimately led to AIDS. You really wouldn't expect a middle schooler of that age to be involved in the gay community at the time, but he was still expelled from his middle school because at that time, people didn't know how HIV was transmitted. But because this happened, now there's an even bigger scare because not only gay men were getting it, but now the blood supply is potentially tainted and it looks like you can transmit HIV through blood. So now this is where the blood ban has really taken form on gay people, because in 2010, 70% of new HIV infections accounted for were with men who had sex with men. And from every single year that we've been tracking this, we find that in between about 60 to 70% of all new infections are coming from men who have sex with men. So now let's get into the real science behind HIV transmission. There was a paper written in 2014 that was by Patel et al. The link is in the description below. It's titled Estimating Per Act HIV Transmission Risk, a Systematic Review. And in here, they look at 8,000 papers filtered down to 15, which looked at how people got infected with HIV. So in this paper, which wasn't just in the United States, they looked at all these different studies and calculated particular risk rates that could happen per 10,000 exposures. And in here, through a large, large sample size, they were able to find that the highest risk for getting HIV infected would be through a blood transfusion. In fact, it looks here that you have about a 93% chance of getting infected if you are transfused with blood that is infected with HIV. Now, interestingly enough, in this paper, they also found that vertical transmission from mother to child, which would be breastfeeding or even maybe just having birth to a child while you are HIV positive, results in about a 23% chance of getting infected. The third highest one is going to be receptive anal intercourse. Now, when I looked through all of the sources that listed on here, this was receptive anal intercourse between men, not necessarily between man and a woman. And mainly that's just because this is the at-risk population, although typically in heterosexual sex, it will be the woman that is on the receptive end, although these days I don't know anymore. And it appears with this men-to-men receptive anal intercourse, you have about a 1.4% chance of getting infected. That would be per exposure. Now, I know people don't normally have sex just once anyways, so this chance is actually getting pretty high with repeated exposures to receptive anal intercourse. Now, the fourth highest one is going to be not that big of a surprise. It's going to be needle sharing with injection drug use. That's why they have clean needle programs in certain countries. But that actually just comes out to 0.6% chance of getting infected. And of course, because these are habitual users, that 0.6% compounds with every single exposure, meaning that if you do it 100 times, there is a pretty big chance that it will have compounded and that you would have gotten infected at some point. Now, of particular note that's interesting on here, insertive anal intercourse gives you a 0.1% chance of getting infected. This would be the person inserting is not infected, but the person receiving is infected. And of course, heterosexual sex, that would be receptive penile to vaginal intercourse, is a 0.08% chance of a risk of infection. And insertive penile vaginal intercourse has a 0.04% chance of getting infection per exposure, meaning that if you are a man having sex with a woman who is infected and you do it vaginally, you have a 0.04% chance of getting infected. Now, it's very interesting to see because from this chart here, gay black men as a percentage are a smaller population here in the United States than gay white men, but yet they account for more infections as a percentage than gay white men. And unfortunately, this leads to black heterosexual women being the fourth most infected population when it comes to HIV infections. Pretty strange given the results here in this paper that there's a 1.4% chance of men getting infected through receptive anal intercourse, but yet black heterosexual women have this high of an infection rate relative to their population. Now, when it comes to the data, and part of the reason why if you are a gay man trying to give blood that you can have had sex for more than a year before you can donate blood. Part of that reason is because to test for HIV inside your blood, HIV doesn't show up right away. So the way that they test for it is something called an antibody, which develops in your blood in response to the exposure and presence of HIV. A lot of times those antibodies don't show up for several days, sometimes months, meaning that if you test HIV negative after a year and haven't had sex in that time, that you are most likely okay to donate that blood. So now, when we go and look at a lot of these news articles, they actually go and neglect this scientific evidence that appears. It's actually publicly available on a Center for Disease Control website. But yet in here, they appeal to emotion by saying that gay blood is the same as anybody else's blood. And to that point, I will definitely agree. Honestly, blood is sexual orientation neutral. Now, the problem is that when you have a high-risk population that is known to have the highest infection rates, then this is part of the reason why we have the ban. But now, interestingly enough, we know that maybe only about 60% of the population who are infected with HIV are gay, meaning that there's 40% of other people who aren't. And what's stopping somebody from having a bunch of promiscuous straight sex and then able to donate blood when a gay man who maybe has had sex once in the last year is not able to donate blood? Now, herein lies the problem. We have this high-risk population that's known for extremely high infection rates compared to heterosexual people. And given the fact that the gay population is much smaller than the heterosexual population, when we have news articles like this that call the FDA policy homophobic, you are strictly negating the evidence. This is scientific evidence. This is the best evidence that we have today. Now, the question then lies, should we not allow gay people to donate blood? And unfortunately, the answer right now, given our regulatory framework, is yes. Because should somebody get infected via blood transfusion because of HIV-infected blood that wasn't screened right, and that the person may have had anal sex just 4 days ago within the time window that HIV would not be able to be detected, that particular person is going to incur a cost of close to $500,000 over their lifetime to just have to pay for the HIV medications. That doesn't include the doctor's visits, that doesn't include the side effects that person has to endure, or the lifestyle changes that need to happen because they now have to take medicines to treat the HIV. This then leads to a huge, huge problem of third-party payers having to deal with these issues and having to pay for all of these drugs. That's going to increase the medical costs for everybody else. And then not to mention the lawsuits that are going to occur when somebody donated blood and unknowingly had HIV, which that is also a really big part of the population too. Now, this is an interesting exercise in allowing government to regulate our lives in the face of infectious disease. When these things go unmitigated, you get things like the Black Death. And quite honestly, government does have a role when it comes to infectious disease. Now, when it comes to chronic diseases, like type 2 diabetes, I don't think that they should really have anything to do with your own actions, or lung cancer with smoking. But then there's also another element of disease, such as Alzheimer's, which we don't even know how it occurs. But with the position that the FDA has and our current regulatory environment, the FDA is acting in their own interests in making this blood ban happen because they can't be liable when HIV-tainted blood enters into the blood supply en masse. And unfortunately, throwing tantrums on the internet saying that these are homophobic policies is not going to help any cause because this is the best data that we have today. Now, could this data be wrong? Absolutely. When it comes to science, you have to always be skeptical. In fact, you should be skeptical of everything that I say. You should try to pull this article up. You should try to read through all of the sources that they cite and see whether or not they align with the proper data that comes out of here. Can you reproduce this? Those are the kinds of questions that you need to ask. I really would like for more blood to be in the supply. Because quite honestly, whenever I work at a hospital, I see that this is a problem. We don't have enough blood. And that more people being able to give blood would be ultimately a better thing. Unfortunately, we have to be careful about it. You have to be better safe than sorry. And that's the conclusion that we have to come to today. They've lifted the ban from lifetime to now 1 year. I would like to see that time be shortened. But as of right now, this is the best data that we have. And this is the science behind it. And we must legislate based on the science, not on our emotions. Anyways, leave a like if you enjoyed this video. I hope you did. Or leave me a comment. I'm sure I will get much hate from this. But trust me, as of this time in this recording, the science has been set. And quite honestly, it's not just the science, but there's a whole bunch of other ethical issues that come up. But subscribe if you'd like to see more. I plan on doing at least one medical video every week. I hope you guys like this kind of stuff. Thanks so much for hanging out with me this weekend, and I'll see you in the next one. Adios, amigos.